So, if you are in the market for an air cooler, Be Quiet just released the Dark Rock Pro 5 and the Dark Rock Elite, and they claim it's better performing, quieter, and easier to install than the predecessor, which would be the Dark Rock Pro 4. They did send me the sample units for review, and in this video, I'm going to show you guys how they performed as I compared it to 5 other air coolers as well. I will have thermals, sound tests, and also a discussion about their installation process and how they ranked amongst each other based on these factors as well as cost. Some of the coolers are going to be around the same price range and some will have a larger gap. The Pro 5 at the time of this video is priced at around $100 US, while the Elite is around $115, at least on Amazon and Newegg. Keep in mind that there are a ton of air coolers on the market and I certainly don't have all of them. But I do believe the ones I did get will serve as good comparisons, references, or context. First off, these two actually have the same 7-pipe heatsink design, and the only difference as far as I can tell is that the Elite cooler has RGB and the fans that are being used. The Elite cooler has 2 135mm Silent Wings fans, while the Pro 5 has a 120mm on the front and 135mm in the middle. Just a quick note. Dark Rock Pro 5 and Elite have updated Silent Wings 4 fans, while the older Pro 4 model has Silent Wings 3. The generational gap in the fan designs does actually contribute to quite a big difference, which you'll see in my thermal discussion later. I am not kidding, it's huge. It's like 14 to 16 degrees delta depending on the setting. On top, you do have the covers that are magnetically attached mainly for aesthetic purposes. Right away, you can see a quick switch for quiet mode and performance mode if you want to change how the fans operate on the fly. Performance mode will allow the 135mm fans to run at 2000 RPM, while quiet mode will cap them at 1500 RPM. For the 120mm fan, performance mode will run them at 1700 RPM and quiet mode will cap it at 1300 RPM. The fan that is installed in the middle of the heatsink on both models are attached via plastic clips on top of the heatsink, which will allow you to easily pop out. Once the middle fan is cleared, you have access to the 2 mounting screws that would secure your cooler to the retention bracket on the motherboard, which you will have to install and prepare prior to this step. Be sure to follow the included instruction manual for the specific steps, as there is a handful of hardware you'll need to assemble. Now, the Dark Rock Pro 5 and Elite did improve on the installation process compared to the Dark Rock Pro 4, but it was really just about 1 to 1.5 steps less. The metal bar that you would have had to manually screw down in the middle of the base is no longer a separate piece in the updated models, but rather part of the base itself. That is pretty much it. It does make it easier. But now that we're here talking about the installation process, I might as well talk about all the coolers and knock them all out. So from top to bottom, top being the easiest and requiring the least amount of steps or hardware to assemble. So Cooler Master Hyper 212 is the simplest, followed by Deepcool's AK620, whereas the Dark Rock Pro 5 and Elite beats the Noctua U12S and U12A, and the Dark Rock Pro 4 at the very bottom. The truth is, the Be Quiet and Noctua coolers all have the same number of steps, but popping out the middle fans on the Pro 5 and Elite was what I thought made it ever so slightly easier than unclamping the wires on the Noctua coolers. Aside from that, assembling the base retention bracket on the motherboard is really where a lot of the work goes in for both Noctua and Be Quiet. Okay, let's talk about temps and then we'll dive into the noise levels afterwards. I tested all the coolers on an open air system to keep things easier across the board rather than worry about all the internal variances in different types of PC chassis on the market. Currently using an ASUS ROG Z790E gaming Wi-Fi motherboard, which ASUS actually provided from a previous video, an Intel i7-13700K CPU, 32GB of Corsair Vengeance DDR5 memory, and an RTX 4090 Fe all powered by Corsair RM850X PSU. I do have XMP on, which sets the memory kit to 6400MHz, and I overclocked the 13700K to hold 5.1 GHz on the P cores and 4.0 on the E cores, while setting the core voltage to 1.25, as each cooler will be going through Cinebench's 30-minute stability test. For Intel 13th gen CPUs, I just can't leave them on stock because they would just pull way too much power unnecessarily, and they would hit TJ Maxx within seconds, and the graphs would just not be a good representation, as you would just see 100 degrees straight across the entire session. So I do have a custom fan curve set, but when running something like Cinebench or applications in similar real-world scenarios, the fans are going to blast 100% for this sort of stress session in most common PC builds, in my opinion. Now, I also ran the fans at 100% for noise testing purposes as well, which we'll get into later. DarkRock Elite does take the lead for keeping the lowest average CPU package temp on performance mode at 72.4, which beats the Noctua U12A, which is actually a more expensive cooler by $15. The Pro 5, in my opinion, basically matches the U12A with only a 0.2 degrees difference. But because the Pro 5 is only $100, I would say it is going to be the better value in terms of temperatures. Now, what's actually crazy is the $64 Deepcool AK620, which performs just as well as the U12A at about half the price, which puts it at an even better value than the U12A and the DarkRock Pro 5. I will say that the Noctua cooler is slightly quieter, which you'll see later. Down at the bottom, another eye-opener would be that the $45 Hyper 212 beats the Pro 4 by 2 degrees at half the price. So the Pro 5 and Elite models made a significant jump by a whopping 14 degrees from their predecessor, at least. I ran the test on Pro 4 a couple times because I thought it was an error. There was no way it was that big of a gap. But I also realized the 120mm Silent Wings 3 on the front maxes out at 1500rpm and the inner 135mm fan maxes out at 1200rpm. I feel like the Silent Wings 4 was a huge improvement to the thermal performance. The scythe blade design does scoop in more air, on top of the fact that they increased the max RPM on the fan speeds for the updated coolers. Now over here is the Pro 4, and I remember testing it when I put my hands behind the heatsink. I could barely feel any air being pushed through, so I knew that that was a confirmation. One thing about the Pro 5 and Elite is that you can adjust the fans on both models to accommodate taller memory kits. The issue with that is it might throw off the aesthetics a little bit if you care, since it's not sitting flush, but it's also going to affect temps. I did the test and DarkRock Elite where the front fan was raised all the way up, and we essentially bumped the temperatures up to about 2 to 2.5 degrees on performance mode. Now, I didn't test both quiet and performance modes on both models, but I would expect to see similar deltas accordingly across the board. Logically, this makes sense because we're losing a bit of airflow here with nearly an inch raised. Now, let's dive into the sound test. So all of the sound tests you just heard were the cooler fans blasting at 100%, and they were all within the mid 40 decibels range according to my decibel meter. The DarkRock coolers do take the lead, which does uphold the Be Quiet name. Another thing I want to mention is that I don't expect or recommend anyone to be constantly running their fans at full blast anyways for an extended amount of time. Also, a reminder that these noise levels are recorded on an open air test, so they will most definitely be lower inside a closed case. So purely from the thermal tests, I just can't recommend the DarkRock Pro 4, period. But in the $100 and above range, I would personally get the DarkRock Elite, because for just $15 more than the Pro 5, it performs cooler by a few degrees, it's quieter, it beats the Noctua on performance mode, and it's cheaper, and it also comes with RGB if you care about that. But if you want something that's under $100, well, the Deepcool AK620 at $64 actually performs nearly just as well as the DarkRock Pro 5, but at a slightly higher noise level. So you can make your own decisions based on your build goals. Now, of course, to clarify, my recommendations were only based on my sample size of coolers here. Okay, so that's all I have. Thanks for watching.